Hello. Well, after we were so rudely interrupted by that fire alarm, I thought I'll just do a couple of bits of recap for where we were in the lecture and then complete it. And we were talking about sponges. This one I bought from Boots, and on the description on the label it just said, "Caution, may contain pieces of seabed." So, let's press on. We had been having a look at this placing of the tenophores at the base of the animal family tree, which means that sponges and placozoans would have lost their ancestral nervous system. It also suggests that mussels have developed twice within the animal kingdom. None of these things are beyond, our understanding of how evolution works, but it does seem to be a little bit strange. So this came about by doing some genome analysis and working out that the sponges contained genes that code for neuropeptides. So it's quite an interesting thing. If they're not using them, what have they got them for? So it might be that the placing of the tenophores as the most basal animal group is a statistical anomaly, but it may be that it's describing a real thing. And we will come back to that because some new evidence has come to light, which sheds a lot of, it increases the evidence for one interpretation over another. So which would it be? Are the porifrons, the sponges, or the tenophorans, the sea gooseberries, at the base of the animal family tree? So we went through this diagram because we were pointing out some of the features that all these different groups share and things which set them apart. So we were talking about the choanoflagellates and the sponges, and those creatures with radial and bilateral symmetry. And we noted that at the root of this tree is the preponderance of receptor tyrosine kinase as one of the cell signaling things, which is unique to this group. So the animals are linked to the choanoflagellates with them. And then that the sponges are multicellular, they have lots of different types of cells. This separates them from the choanoflagellates, which are just those cells. And choanoflagellates are colonial, which means that any of their cells can reproduce, whereas reproduction and reproductive effort is maintained by a few cells within the sponge. And then the next branch of the family tree is the one that includes true tissues, and that leads to those animals with either bilateral or radial symmetry. And I invited you to have a look at the fine structure of a choanoflagellate, which shows a single flagellum emerging from the cell base with a cone of villi around it that increases the surface area to the volume, which means that they can absorb more food and more, they can do gaseous exchange more easily. So let's move on to the sponges, phylum Porifera. And in when we were discussing the different shapes of sponges, we ended up with the most complex type of sponges, the leuconoid ones, which have a huge number of folds containing flagellated chambers, i.e., the cells in them have flagella. And they're connected by canals. And I noted that the only place with these furry cells are inside these chambers. And that specialized cell is the choanocyte. They cannot live on their own. They have to be part of the member of the cells in a sponge, but they do look very similar to the choanoflagellates. And in typical diagrams, when you cut through a sponge and you have a look at them under the microscope, you have a big difference between the cells that you find inside, in the chambers inside the cell, and those that are on the outside. So we have a number here. I think first is not a cell, but a product of one of the roving amoebocytes, the amoebic-like cells inside the sponge, which secretes spicules. Spicules are like little bits of armor. We'll see a few more of those in a moment, because some of them have got really dramatic morphology. Then there's the outside of the sponge, which are pinacocytes. And then porocytes, which are a cell that has a hole going through the middle of them, so that they are cylindrical, and they are the ones which guard or allow water to transmit from the outside to the inside. And of course, that hole is called the ostium, and it leads to the spongocele, the cavities inside the cell's body. Then there's this sort of jelly layer, the mesenchyme or matrix, onto which the cells are embedded so they do not move. Inside that matrix are patrolling amoebocytes, again, amoeba-like cells that move around. There are the specialized sclerocytes, which secrete the spicules, and the choanocytes, which are only on the inside and are the cells that create the current that draws water through the ostium and out through the oscula and brings in the food on which they feed. Then, in November 2021, came this paper which changed everything. Profiling cellular diversity in sponges informs animal cell types and nervous system evolution. It was a very technical paper, and they certainly went the extra mile to make sure all their assertions were fully evidenced and explored in detail. I can't think of anything else that they could have done to make this paper more complete. So they were using single cell RNA analysis. So what that means is that they're taking the cell, they're extracting the RNA from it, and they're categorizing it to see what sort of proteins are being made. Now, in that previous slide, I had about, you know, less than half a dozen of cells, but they found 18 types of cells. This was not what we were expecting, because of course, with the microscope, you're only looking at different morphologies of cells. So if two similar looking cells are doing something completely different, that would be cryptic, that would be hard to see. So 18 types of cells. But they also found that in the choanocytes, in those flagellated cells, they were transcribing proteins that formed what in other animals would be called the postsynaptic scaffold, involved in the reception of neurotransmitters. Well, this was unusual to say the least. But they also found that there were some of these amoebocytes, these amoeba-like cells, which they called neuroids, because they were producing proteins active in presynaptic cells. This was a shock. But you might say nervous systems act by the interaction of cells that are closely touching each other. But what they found, and this was one of the really nice bits of work that they did, and in fact having to use very high powered equipment to visualize what was going on at the molecular level, but they found that these neuroid cells have to touch the choanocytes in order to have their effect. There's a picture of one, the purple cell towards the base, only partially obscured by my image, is the neuroid. the neuroid, which it looks like an amoebocyte, and the green is the choanocyte with the long, thin green flagella, quite clearly seen pointing downwards. So the neuroid cells have to touch the choanocytes to have an effect. What they also found was that the neuroid cells are expressing immune genes which differentiate between cells of the self, of the sponge, and food, another any other thing that's travelling through the sponge. As you can imagine, sponges are pulling water through at quite a rate, so anything that comes into them could be quite harmful. So these neuroid cells are kind of patrolling what's inside the sponge spongocele. And when they discover that there is a blockage or too much of one sort of intruding cell, they affect the choanocytes so they all beat in unison or stop beating for a moment. And that alters the flow rate. So if there's a blockage, these neuroid cells actually cause like a spasm of contraction to expel the foreign particles, which basically means that in sponges, a temporary part-time nervous system has evolved in order to make them belch. And sponges are fantastic pumps. So an upshot of the beating of these choanocytes is this enormous through flow of water from the outside through these spongocele chambers and then out through the oscula. So a sponge can pump 20,000 times its own volume every day. As you can imagine, that is very good news for the sponge if it's going to eat all the organic content in it, like the bacteria. And some sponges trap 90% of all the bacteria that pass through them. This then can completely change water composition. And indeed, sponges are the mops of the the marine and a few freshwater environments, and they have this enormous effect on purifying water and increasing water quality. And I have this little video taken from YouTube that demonstrates it. Now we know. What a fantastic demonstration of how dramatically sponges pass water through their bodies. And this actually works for their reproduction. So, of course, you can break a bit of a sponge off and it can regenerate from fragments. And many of them are hermaphrodite, which means, of course, that they're producing eggs and sperm. The choanocytes generally form the reproductive cells, i.e. they de-differentiate from this collared flagellate cell and then produce either eggs or sperm. These are released, the sperm are released into the water and are taken up in the same way as food. They enter through the sponge pinacocytes and then combine with the eggs when they're in the spongocoel. And then they're pumped out as fertilized eggs into the environment. And the larval stage, which is a little ciliated disc of cells, settles away from the parent and sets up on its own. But again, for those that have these larval stages, they're born with the cilia on the inside. So the cells are pointing the wrong way, and therefore the larval stage has to invert to form a blastula. But it continues to evert, a bit like the video we saw last time of the Volvox, which has the same problem. And there's one. So we might look at this and think, a sponge plants itself on the seabed, and while a lot of it is this squeezy stuff, or it's chalk or glass, why doesn't everything eat sponges? Two good reasons. After all, yeah, so sponges look good to eat, they don't move much, highly visible, nutritious cell levels, but most of the sponge is armor or spongin, and that can include spikes, a rubbery texture, and nasty poisons sequestered from food or manufactured internally. And that caught the eye of pharmaceutical companies. So in the 1950s, Caribbean sponges were analyzed for useful chemicals. And they found two nucleosides in particular. Now, nucleosides are nucleotides, like the ones that make up DNA and RNA, but missing a phosphate from the structure. And spongothymidine and spongouridine were found, and they've been incredibly important because they interfere with the synthesis of viral DNA. And indeed, these products coming from sponges have been used to combat HIV, AIDS, herpes, leukemia, and indeed COVID-19. Not bad for a small sessile organism that most people ignore. Why doesn't everything eat sponges? Because they are packed full of indigestible sharp objects. So this is a squashed piece of sponge showing the spicules, and they are everywhere and sharp. This was a diagram of types of spicules that you can find in sponges, but in some of the microscope slide collection that we hold in the university, you can see them from yourself. They look like medieval torture equipment. These are like those nails that have ridges around them to make sure they can't come out. You don't want to mess with a sponge. And these are from a scanning electron microscope of some of the sponge spicules found in deep waters near Iceland. And some of these sponges use their silica producing capacities to form these beautiful baskets. And oddly enough, they're these social shrimps that enter into these Venus's baskets when they're babies, and they grow up and they get too large to leave. So they live as a little community inside the sponge. And when it comes for them to breed, their fertilized eggs waft out because they're small enough to fit through the gaps, and they go on to find new hosts, and they keep them clean. One of the interesting things about Venus's baskets is that the glass acts a bit like a fiber optic. So you often have algae growing at the base, which would not normally receive enough light had it not been for the silicon dioxide superstructure which acts as a fiber optic to bring light to them. And spicules have been very important for human civilization. So flint is a form of quartz that is formed by dissolved silica permeating the seabed and filling the holes in limestone or sandstone left by burrowing creatures or dead animals that have been encased and the fleshy parts have washed away like sea urchins. The source of the silica for this formation of flint is likely to be spicules from sponges and the silicon dioxide that comes from some plankton such as diatoms. Now, flint has been used by people who weren't human for 2.5 million years. Tools made from sponge spicules. If you want to see them, pop down to the Archaeology Museum in the Ginogli part of the Lakeside Art Centre and they're on display and you can have a look at them yourselves. What sponges haven't managed to do is to move, but some of them have had a penchant for settling on crabs, so there are some moving sponges, just not on their own. Now, moving on from sponges, we've got another member of these asymmetrical groups of animals called the placozoans. Now, they exist as a small flat plate that can move in any direction and form, well, what if they were amoeba, they'd say you form pseudopodia, but they're not a single cell, they're multicellular. So these are pseudopodia because they can just extrude themselves in any direction. They have no symmetry. And the multicellular body plan is quite interesting. It consists of an upper cell layer, so a layer on the dorsal side. Most of those have a flagellum, so there's this beating movement of water circulating around them. Then there's a fluid-filled cavity with a network of fibre cells that do the business of contracting this organism in different directions so it can change its shape. And then at the bottom, you've got a lower layer of flagellated cells and glandular cells that secrete enzymes so they can break down their food, which is whatever they choose to eat. Here's some images of them from a recent paper. And they were mistaken for the mobile larvae of sponges or cnidarians, which we'll come to next week, until 1971, when it was realised that they are a group of their own. Their reproduction is generally by asexual fission, which is splitting in half, or budding, where a small bit breaks off and makes its own way. Now, sperm and eggs have been seen, but their development and what sort of meiosis they have has not been observed. They have the smallest genome in the animal kingdom, which was sequenced in 2008. But that doesn't necessarily mean anything, because small genomes just mean they need to have a very high rate of mitosis, because the fewer genes you have to replicate, the quicker you can do it. But they do have transcription factors and signaling pathway genes that are typically associated with a much more diverse cell type and lots of developmental processes. Is this degenerate? Well, we just don't know. So the position of the placozoa is unresolved. Some people in section A have put them at the very base of the animal family tree here. So they branched off, let's do it in a better colour. So they branched off before the sponges. Some think that they're a bit more organised by sponges and they don't have choanocytes. So maybe they developed after the sponges, but before the radial and bilateral symmetrical organisms. And others have thought that maybe they're degenerate bilateralia. This would not be the first time something like that has been postulated. So maybe they are much further along the family tree than the sponges and the radially symmetrical creatures. The answer is, at the moment, we don't know. Waiting for more research to resolve their position. And in that case, we can get a trifurcation. So this is an unresolved branch, not quite sure where the placozoans fit, but they are, you know, maybe with a little bit more research or some lucky finds, we'll know more about them. But because of the things that they share with the sponges and all other animals, they're definitely in the animal kingdom. And that's where we were going to go with this lecture. That was interrupted by the fire alarm. Next week, we're going to start with radial symmetry and more animals that only have two cell layers. So until then, cheerio. Have a good break.